There are some things you can only experience once. The most obvious experience we jump to when we hear this is a first kiss, though it could also apply to the wonder felt at seeing the Grand Canyon for the first time, the triumph felt after first successfully riding your bike without falling. While you may experience some form of joy through subsequent lovers, or the infinitesimal feeling of being adjacent to that canyon again, or the freedom that your bike provides, you won't remember those experiences nearly as well as the first. For the first isn't just a moment. It's a monument, a beginning. And for beginnings to, well, begin, some things, they have to end. I'm Oshism, and this is Outer Wilds.
While that was dramatic, it is one of the main themes explored by Mobius Digital's Outer Wilds, a game that, and I cannot stress this enough, can only truly be experienced once. So if it ever interested you, I implore you to go play the game for yourself before you watch this video. If you're still here, I'm going to assume that you've either played the game, have no interest to, weren't listening, or you're a little slow, and that's okay, champ. Either which way, welcome. And spoilers. The Outer Wilds is a game that's been stuck on my Steam wish list for years, and every so often when I would get a month of Game Pass, I would toss it on the list of games that I'm totally gonna play this time. But somehow it always evaded me, seemingly waiting to present itself to me in full force when the time was right. And as much as I'd only ever hear distant echoes of people's praises for the game, there was something odd about the reviews that I would see. They refused to talk about the contents of the game, citing that this game is something you can only experience once. Interesting then, how a review that refuses to talk about the game it's reviewing could possibly be one of the most honestly intriguing reviews of all time. It wasn't just one person, either. It's a whole community of people talking about how unbelievably incredible this game is, but should not, nay cannot, tell you why. And that's why my review ends here, with the following minutes taken up by a black screen and the repeated sounds of turtles fucking in the background. Thanks for watching. Okay, maybe that's not the best note to end on, but for real, I had an incredible experience with this game that I would have never been able to have if the community that loves this game didn't do such a good job of warning people about spoilers really ruining things, so this is actually your last call because there is going to be spoilers from here on out. The Outer Wilds opens up in a very somber way. You, the player character, wake up at a campfire with an old friend that you've known seemingly forever on the planet of Timber Hearth. Above you, something collides in space in front of a planet. You have the chance to talk to your friend, who tells you how excited he is that you're going to be expeditioning into space, and you can roast a marshmallow, provided you don't burn it like the unskilled twat you are.
Fuck!
You venture into town to get launch codes that will allow you to take your ship and embark on your journey. As you walk through town, talking to the locals, you're first introduced to one of the things that really makes this game special, the characters. These guys, the common folk of your small village, are of a race called Hearthians. And the Hearthians are so fucking wholesome, it's near impossible not to feel welcome in this tiny little town. You climb all the way up to the observatory where you meet with Hornfels. They're excited, yet sad, to see you go. A bittersweet goodbye that you can tell is laced with something you're not privy to. They remind you of a tool that will allow you to tune to the sounds of other Hearthians that have made their trek into space, given they're playing the instruments Mima had given them before they departed. I will note that I wasn't given one because she knows that my skill would be out of this fucking world. You're also given a translation device in hopes that you might uncover ancient texts in the ruins of a long past civilization called the Nomai. As you go to leave, something bizarre happens. A statue moves on its own, looking directly at you with eyes that were closed just moments before. You panic and tell one of your friends about it, who might just toss you into a psych ward, and rightfully so. With the launch codes in hand, you say your last goodbyes and go to your ship. Which, by the way, they mentioned multiple times is a fucking death trap. Good luck. I personally felt this bittersweetness, looking over the town before getting into my ship and brutally whiffing the controls. And the moment that you lift off and begin your first venture into space, something in the game shifts. The safety and warm welcome of your hometown is stripped. You're greeted by a small number of planets and a sun with a vast amount of nothingness covering the distance between. You are alone out here. You are not safe out here. It's just you and your ship with no clear goal in mind. Now's the time where I, much like Hornfels earlier, remind you of the signal scope, the frequency scanner that you're equipped with. This thing is probably the only saving grace you might encounter in the bleak and unforgiving void of space. Using it, you're greeted with the comforting sounds of Harthian adventurers playing their instruments when you point your signal scope to the planet that they're on. For some context, let's break those planets down into bite-sized chunks, starting with the Addle Rock. The Addle Rock is Timber Hearth's moon, and is the most immediate rock in the solar system. Pointing your signal scope to the moon, you hear a whistling tune, one that I still can't get out of my head. When you head over to Addle Rock, you uncover the source of the whistling. An old, lonely Harthian named Esker, who's been out here for many, many years. They tell you about the signal scope perch they built elsewhere on Addle Rock to listen to the sounds of the other adventurers' instruments, taking comfort in the knowledge that they're safe.
Fuck, this guy's so wholesome.
Yet when you get there, you find notes alluding to something being off. You see, a Harthian named Feldspar went missing on his voyage, never to return or make contact with anyone ever again. Yet Esker notes that when he points his signal scope to Timber Hearth, he hears the sound of a harmonica. A harmonica that would have belonged to the presumed dead Feldspar. This is one of the first mysteries the game presents to you. The other presented to you is the large spinning device found on the southern pole of the moon. When you move this ball into any of the slots representing one of the corresponding space bodies, the rings around you align with said body. But there's one symbol that, when the ball is placed in the slot, causes the rings to erratically and endlessly spin. Through the Nomai translator that you're equipped with, this should be the first mention of something called the Eye, among other things that we'll touch back on later. Now, just because Addle Rock is the first intended place of travel, that doesn't necessarily mean that that's where you're gonna go. In a sense, Outer Wilds is an open world game in the best way. That's actually one of the beautiful things about this game, and I can't say that about a lot of open world games. During my playthrough, the first planet I traveled to was Giant's Deep. A stark contrast to the dry emptiness of the Addle Rock, Giant's Deep is a planet covered with an immense amount of water. And from that water rises a chaotic storm of tornadoes, rivaling that of Texas. Twisters that are able to throw the few islands the planet even has out into orbit, only to come crashing back down later on. How the Nomai decided that this planet was even slightly fucking inhabitable is beyond me. On Giant's Deep, you meet Gabbro, another Harthian that's taken up camp on this island because they're a masochist, I think. This planet is where I, and I assume many other players, will have their first experience with death. Death in Outer Wilds, much like in life, presents an even larger mystery to be uncovered. This is because, unlike life, Outer Wilds allows you to live again. However, it doesn't just reset you and give you a game over screen when you die. It shows you a flashback of everything you did during your lifetime, and then you wake up. Under the stars, greeted by that same campfire, that same old friend, that same collision in space. And canonically, you remember dying. And when you talk to Slate about it, he, rightfully so, thinks that you're fucking nuts. And maybe you are, but on your next trip to Giant's Deep, should you find yourself in conversation with Gabbro, they mention that they remember dying too, over and over and over. I wonder why. From here, curiosity propels you as the main questline for this game, and the threads sew deeper and deeper as you explore. If you're not the kind of person that's intrigued by a natural sense of discovery, I can understand why this game might turn you off. But when I tell you that it got me Addle Rock hard, you better fucking believe it. Continuing forth is Brittle Hollow. Brittle Hollow is simultaneously one of the most interesting planets in the game, and one of the most frustrating. it technically should be your first encounter with how Outer Wilds handles the passage of time. Once you wake up, a timer begins, and as time progresses, whether you choose to use it to explore or terrorize your hometown, things change in the galaxy. One such thing is how Brittle Hollow's moon regularly bombards the planet's shell. What an asshole. Due to Brittle Hollow's high instability, the planet's fragile crust is broken up by these bombardments, then falling into a black hole at the core of the planet. This can reveal to the player a number of things. First is that Brittle Hollow isn't all that it seems. For if you look under the crust of the planet, you'll find underground structures and settlements rich with lore. Second is that if you're unlucky and happen to be standing on the wrong section of the planet at the wrong time while you're exploring, you're doomed to fall with the crust into the depths of the black hole. And instead of just killing you, it warps you out into one of the furthest reaches of the solar system, emerging out of a white hole, most likely without your ship, doomed to fly around using your oxygen until you die a slow, painful death. Lest you, unlike me, discover that there is a white hole orbital station nearby that can actually teleport you back to Brittle Hollow, but I never discovered this until I went to write this script, so I guess I'll go fuck myself. The slowest and most painful part of this process is the fact that in order to discover everything Brittle Hollow has to offer, which is quite a lot, you have to repeat this process multiple times, sometimes resulting in a failure and menu restart out of frustration. This happened to me on multiple occasions on this and a couple other planets, and I found that rather frustrating. This might be my only critique of the game itself. Though, let's say you don't die on Brittle Hollow's crusts, or in Giant's Deep's ocean, or out in the cold vacuum of space. You're thinking to yourself, wow, I'm so fucking cool, and a great and fantastic explorer that can never die, because I'm God, and everyone including the solar system, no matter what you do, no matter how much you uncover, no matter how you survive, for some reason, or maybe not one at all, you and everyone you love must die. Every 22 minutes, to be exact. With a failure to believe that this is just some arbitrary amount of time the developers thought would be funny to fuck with all your progress, you might find that this is another key element to the mystery unfolding in front of your very eyes. All four of them. You awake again with newfound information and a renewed lust for discovery. The information you uncover on Brittle Hollow should most likely point you in the direction of another set of planets that suffer from the same accursed affliction of being very interesting but having very annoying mechanics, the Hourglass Twins. Like Brittle Hollow, the Hourglass Twins progressively change over the 22-minute period before Supernova. There's the Ashtwin, completely submerged in sand at the beginning of the time loop, and the Ember Twin, a planet rich with lore that slowly becomes submerged by the Ash Twin's sand deposits as time progresses. Again, in concept and in execution, these planets are fucking incredible. And in being a waste of my precious time, they're impeccable. You require a lot of knowledge from Ember Twin to progress in the game, most of which is found in its underground cave systems. Cave systems which, if you haven't pieced it together yet, are being filled with fucking sand. While this is happening, though, much more of what the Ash Twin hides becomes revealed, allowing you to explore and gather information there too, that, while important, is not nearly as beneficial to you as Ember Twin right now. For example, Ember Twin contains an important piece of information within the depths of its sunless city that makes one of the most terrifying death trap planets in the entirety of this and maybe any game into just one of the most terrifying planets in the entirety of this and maybe any game. And that is Dark Bramble. First off, fuck Dark Bramble. Second off, fuck Dark Bramble, dude. I cannot stress it enough. If up until now the existential dread and despair of being alone and unsafe in the void of space, knowing that no matter what you do, you and everything you've ever known and loved is destined to die at the hands of an uncaring sun at the end of its life cycle, has not convinced you that this is a horror game, then let Dark Bramble do so. Behold. Side note, if you're paying attention, you may have noticed that when the signal scope is pointed at Dark Bramble, you receive an ominous harmonica signal, one that's strikingly similar to the one that you find when you point it to Timber Hearth. Peculiar, isn't it? Okay, back to the horror. This clip was probably one of the most terrifying experiences I've had in a game in a hot minute, and I've played PT and Cooking Mama. I might be biased, as this game touches on my fear of open waters more than a couple of times because Mobius Games made Outer Wilds to spite me, I guess, but I think it's an irrefutable fact that the atmosphere of Dark Bramble is horrifying. The ambiance, the fear of what's lurking in the fog, the impossible size of the inside given the size of the outside, this planet is a living nightmare. One that you can't skip if you want to finish the game, because there's nothing more fun than suffering, I guess. I mentioned before that you discover something on Ember Twin about this planet that makes it survivable. Through your excursions on Ember Twin, you figure out that the anglerfish of the Bramble are blind, so when you're moving through, you have to do so extremely slowly so they can't hear, and then subsequently kill you. Discovering this removes the fear of the unknown and replaces it with the tension of having to constantly move slowly through one of the most dangerous areas in the game, hoping you don't attract one of these ugly mugs. If you're to succeed, you stumble across the long gone but not forgotten Feldspar. Contrary to popular beliefs, they're not dead. They're just chilling in the remains of an angler skeleton trying to come up with the melody to DaBaby's next song. Now, if you remember the side note I made not that long ago, you also hear Feldspar's harmonica when you point the signal scope to Timber Hearth. If you follow that signal, it brings you to another section of the planet where a bramble seed has crash-landed, its roots already beginning to find their way into the ground. Due to the peculiar and otherworldly mechanics of the bramble, this actually connects it with the large bramble floating in the solar system, and presumably all other brambles in the universe, given there are more. This bramble seed is the cherry on top of the unrelenting fate of your friends and family who, unbeknownst to them, think it just needs a little bit of old-fashioned axe chopping. To understand why this is so horrible for the Hearthians, it's time I give you a SparkNotes breakdown of a separate tragedy that's told over the course of the game. The fate of the ancient Nomai. One of the main driving factors of the game is discovering the texts and technology left behind by the Nomai, and uncovering the mystery of what happened to them. The Nomai are a technologically advanced nomadic race from another solar system that breaks off into separate groups and travels the universe in hopes of discovery. This is the story of Eskel's vessel, which traveled to the Hearthian system long, long ago after receiving a mysterious signal from something in the universe that seemed older than the universe itself. With their curiosity piqued, they traveled to the source of the signal. As you explore through the game, you encounter fallen escape pods emitting distress signals. These escape pods contained many Nomai that had to escape from the main vessel due to something horrible happening to it. These Nomai begin to inhabit the planets they land on, rebuilding their technology until they're able to inhabit the remainder of the solar system. Using resources from these planets, they were able to create some incredible technology, the first of which was the eye signal locator which we find on Attlerock, which they used to attempt to relocate the signal that brought them here in the first place. The signal emitted from what they now call the Eye of the Universe. But something was wrong. When used to locate the other planets in the solar system, it worked fine. Tuning it to the eye, however, caused the locator to spin endlessly, unable to locate it. Deciding that this intergalactic location device wasn't sophisticated enough, they made another more complicated one on Brittle Hollow within an observatory built along its north pole. This one ultimately also failed. In the meantime, they had been able to make observations of, and eventually land on, another anomaly in this solar system, the Quantum Moon. The Quantum Moon is the moon of, well, all of the planets in the solar system. Sometimes it's at one, sometimes it's at another, seemingly without explanation, so let me explain that shit. This is a great time to explore quantum mechanics. Not real-life quantum mechanics, who do you think I am? Quantum mechanics as explained in the game. Outer Wilds has three rules pertaining to quantum mechanics. 1. A quantum object is nowhere yet everywhere all at once until observed, in which case it stays in place. When one observing the quantum object looks away, the object becomes impermanent again. 2. If somebody is touching the quantum object and the object is no longer observed, that which is touching the object travels with the object itself until observed again. 3. Observing an image of the object is equivalent to observing the object itself. You discover this information on the Nomai Tower of Quantum Trials, which is conveniently located in the middle of a huge fucking tornado on Giant's Deep. And using this information, you too can land on the Quantum Moon, which otherwise uses the mist that conceals it to teleport should you try to enter its orbit. When the Nomai discovered this, they also found out that the Quantum Moon is actually the eye of the universe's moon, though concealed by the moon's atmosphere. The Nomai wanted to build a probe that would allow them to visually witness the eye. They were worried, however, that they would only have one shot to succeed, with astronomical room for error. While utilizing the black hole on Brittle Hollow, they found that an object or person entering the black hole would arrive at the corresponding white hole before they departed. With this newfound information, they entered production of the Ashtwin project. This project was created in hopes that the Nomai would be able to cause the sun to supernova, so that they could harness the power and send themselves back in time, allowing them to continuously fire the probe until they located the eye. In order for this project to succeed, there are a couple key mechanics at play. One, the orbital probe cannon, which will be used to locate the exact coordinates of the eye should it be found. Two, memory statues, which are linked with the closest individual the moment the eye is located to record their consciousness. Three, a Nomai mask, which stores the statue individual's consciousness and allows them to be rebirthed and use the eye's coordinates to actually travel to it. They were able to successfully build all three components of this technology, though don't ask me fucking how. Powered by an advanced warp core, it was operational, but they needed more power to allow the full control of the loop that they were creating. After careful calculations, they found that the power of a supernova should be able to send them all back roughly 22 minutes in time. This amount of time might sound familiar to you. They began constructing a station with the hopes that the technology on it would allow them to manually induce a supernova, giving them full control of how many probe launches they were able to do at any given time until they finally got it right. But this sun station failed, and before the Nomai were ever able to figure out why, or find an alternative, a comet named the Interloper entered the solar system, erupting a dangerous substance called ghost matter once it got a certain distance from the sun. This ghost matter eradicated all life in the solar system, including the Nomai. Fast forward, and I mean way forward, about like 200,000 years later, the sun naturally reaches the end of its lifetime. A new species has taken those years to become sentient and advanced enough to begin space travel, the Harthians. This is where the whole tragedy of Outer Wilds shines. By the time you touch the controller, the Harthians have unknowingly relived the same 22 minutes and the same tragic deaths over and over and over. 9,314,054 times, to be exact. The probe shoots and shoots and shoots until it finally finds the eye. Conveniently, at the same time, you're leaving to embark on your journey. The memory statue pairs with you by chance, and curses you with the knowledge of your immortality, doomed to know that the system ends in pain and death. And say, in theory, you are able to find a way to prevent the sun from dying. You're not, but say you could. The Harthians are still condemned to death by the bramble seed that landed on the planet. You see, the bramble is the reason the Nomai failed in the first place. When they warped to the solar system, their vessel became entangled with a bramble seed that consumed them until they could not escape. And should you be unfortunate enough to travel back, you can find the vessel itself, along with the dead. The Dark Bramble is like a weed, a scourge of space that consumes planets and solar systems until they're nothing but a blip in the infinite hell that is the Bramble. If the Nomai couldn't escape it, surely the Harthians don't stand a chance. So it is then that no matter what you do, your friends and family are doomed. To add to the tragedy, the Nomai who worked so unbelievably hard to achieve this goal will never, ever know that they actually succeeded. All because of a freak natural disaster. Once you know all of the mechanics required to get to the canon ending, the game becomes a very clear, linear path. So linear that if you had this information going into it, you could do it on your first loop and miss out on the entire adventure. The knowledge needed is the coordinates of the eye found underneath Giant's Deep, how to get into the Ashtwin project on the Ashtwin, and where to find the vessel in the Dark Bramble. Let me break down how you do this as fast as possible. Start the loop, get in your ship, fly to Ashtwin, wait for the sand level to drop so you can go in this door, park your ship under the bridge so the sand doesn't send it to Ember Twin, wait in this cubby, wait until the sand is pouring over the building, enter the Ashtwin project, look at the scary masks, go and get the advanced warp core, get the fuck out of there, get in your ship, head to the Dark Bramble, go in the Dark Bramble, locate the third escape pod,
follow the cubes,
shoot a scout into the Bramble Sea, follow the signal, stay very, very fucking still, enter the vessel, place the advanced warp core in the vessel, use the coordinates of the eye to activate the black hole warp, enter the black hole, do this, and you warp to the eye of the universe. You're the first person to ever actually perceive it. An ethereal storm of quantum energy that, until now, has been omnipresent. You watch a star explode in the distance. Your friends are dead. Only this time, they can't come back. You made sure of that. An end to an unknown suffering. You roam the chaos until you get to the edge of a cliff with no other choice but to jump. And when you do, you're taken into one of the trippiest experiences you may ever have in the ending of a game. You find yourself falling in a storm of pure chaos. You land back at the observatory on Timber Hearth, where you see your solar system. Observing it pulls you all the way back, reminding you that although your discoveries felt large, like you had solved this ginormous universal puzzle, you're actually still nothing in comparison to the size of space. Finding yourself in a forest filled with every version of your solar system that was, is, and will be, until they all die, leaving you in complete darkness. Things get pretty strange until a fire appears in front of you. You light the fire, and because you've learned nothing, you burn the marshmallow again. Eventually, Esker appears, asking you to gather the instruments for the memories of your dear friends and family. Once you do, it's time to kick things off, one last time. In one final hurrah, a subconscious forgiving of the self, everybody's music is played all together. The sun is going out, every sun is going out, but the eye provides you with the only thing left that matters, bringing the people you love together. A beautiful cacophony to play out the end of the universe. But as sad and as terrifying as it is, you feel acceptance. For some things must end before a beginning can begin. And while some things can be experienced over and over again, some things can only be experienced once.